Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves, continuing medical education podcast. Join us for a lively discussion on the latest and greatest in the field of electrocardiography. We'll discuss some of the exciting and innovative work happening at Mayo Clinic and beyond with the most brilliant minds in the space and provide valuable insights that can be directly applied to your practice. Welcome to Mayo Clinic's ECG segment, Making Waves. In this episode, we explore how pulsed field ablation, PFA, has reshaped the treatment of atrial fibrillation and really changed clinical practice in electrophysiology. Unlike traditional thermal or cryo-based approaches, PFA uses high-voltage electrical pulses to precisely target tissue, and it's really tissue-specific, and it offers a new level of safety, speed, and precision that we're seeing in practice. Now, well, after 1 year of using this and integrating this into our practice here at Mayo Clinic, the impact has really changed. And joining us again are two of our electrophysiologists, Dr. Christopher DeSimone and Dr. Abhishek Deshmukh, both cardiac electrophysiologists here at Mayo Clinic in Rochester. Dr. Christopher DeSimone is an associate professor of medicine. He specializes in complex EP procedures. He serves as the director of the Heart Rhythm Services Research and director of marketing for the Mayo Clinic Cardiovascular Enterprise. And, you know, very well known, both of our guests in the research field, Dr. DeSimone with over 400 publications, more than 50 patent applications, and really doing a lot of innovative work in catheter ablation and ventricular arrhythmia research. And Dr. Abhishek Deshmukh, who's an associate professor of medicine and the co-director of the electrophysiology fellowship program, which I'm a part of. He's my program director, and I'm grateful for that. He specializes in arrhythmia care in patients with infiltrative cardiomyopathy and congenital heart disease. Dr. Deshmukh is also very well known internationally, well over 400 publications, and leads the research program focused on large-scale data analysis and very active in the AI ECG space. Dr. DeSimone and Dr. Deshmukh, thank you so much for joining us again.
It's our pleasure. Thank you so much for having us.
Thanks, Anthony.
All right. So, Dr. Deshmukh, let's start with you. You know, this whole year of now, full year of experience of PFA in practice, and I know you've used it quite a bit. How has it changed your practice over the last year in terms of atrial fibrillation management?
So, thanks, Anthony. So, you know, PFA has been around for a while, and, you know, Dr. DeSimone and Dr. Asirvatham here were some of the early pioneers in understanding actually the biophysics of pulse field ablation. So, whenever they would talk to us about electroporation, you know, they were always very excited. And so, everybody wanted to see how this thing works like. So, at least, you know, we have been doing it for the last 1 year here at Mayo. Probably as a group, we must have done 1,000 plus cases now. And overall experience so far has been quite promising and quite user friendly. You know, initially, there was always a concern whether the learning curve is going to be steep with any other procedure. But I can tell you, most EPs took to it like fish to the water. So, everybody's, you know, got quite comfortable with the ablation as they started, to the point that it has become a little bit more simpler now to do an AF ablation, because you don't have to look at many things, you know, from the biophysics standpoint, because of the standard program, standard biophysical parameters, what they are used for ablation. So when, you know, I mean, there are two aspects of PFA ablation now in practice. Rather, I would say three. Number one, the safety of the procedure. And, you know, there are always going to be some vascular access related issues and, you know, perforations in the heart. You know, again, some of those things can occur. But the worst complication, what can happen with an AF ablation, which would keep all the electrophysiologists awake all night, would be atrioesophageal fistula because of heating of the esophagus while ablating on the posterior wall of the left atrium. And that practically, as far as I understand, has never been reported in any studies which have looked at PFA ablation. So, you know, that has been a huge thing, that the esophagus has been spared, because the death because of that would not happen right away, but would happen in a few weeks by the time, you know, everybody moves on from that procedure. But, you know, then you get this unfortunate news that something bad happened to the patient. So that has been really good, because it has been sparing the neighboring structures and just being more selective towards the myocardium. I think definitely the procedure has become much more safer. and much more quicker and efficient. I think that has really changed. It's a new skill set now for doing a PFA ablation compared to what we would do with radio frequency ablation. But I think once you have the inherent basics of knowledge of moving the catheter in the left atrium, it doesn't seem that difficult. You know, so far we have had good results also with PFA ablation. Again, time will tell, you know, how much recurrence we see after an ablation. But so far, our initial impressions have been quite promising with both the PFA systems, what at least I have used in my practice.
Yeah, and that's what, you know, seems to be it. And Dr. DeSimone, anything else you kind of add? And what's your experience been like,
yeah,
you know, with this?
Agree with Dr. Deshmukh completely. And I'll add some other things. You know, this PFA, we want to kind of say what it is and what it isn't. What it isn't is the cure to AFib, or it's not the cure to all of these atrial arrhythmia problems. They're still going to be there. Right now, I don't think it's the data's upon us to say, yes, it's better, or you're going to have less AFib. We don't have trial data that points us that way. But I think, as Abhishek mentioned, the biggest thing for us is patient safety. That's the pinnacle, right? And I think clearly it's made this procedure safer. Atrial esophageal fistulas, pulmonary vein stenosis, phrenic nerve palsy. Those are things that we're very, very afraid of. And we still maintain vigilance, but are less worried or concerned based on the data we've had for several years from Europe as well as the United States, that this is a more safer procedure. So to me, I don't really mind if pulse field ablation is a little bit better or a little bit worse in terms of its efficacy, but I really love that it seems to be much safer. I think that's the benefit and how that changes my practice. In terms of timing, it's more efficient procedure, meaning you're not going step by step. And Dr. Deshmukh and I both would predominantly, overwhelmingly use radio frequency ablation, where you're kind of using a smaller electrode tip and going point to point to isolate the pulmonary veins as your primary means of treating atrial fibrillation. Some others would use cryoablation to where they're using a balloon and they're sort of going in each vein itself and doing that. And that's a more efficient procedure. But here, when we're doing these procedures, I think there's several benefits. So keeping the patient under general anesthesia for less time absolutely has tremendously changed the practice. Patients are, by the time you get to the recovery room and see them, they're up, they're ready to eat, drink, and ready to go home. I mean, that's been a big, big deal for patients who might have been older or sicker and might have had more problems or difficulties with anesthesia. I think in terms of how I approach or when I select patients for atrial fibrillation, I don't think that's changed at all. I still think that whatever patient I would put on that table to do an ablation is the same regardless if we were still using radio frequency thermal ablation or relatively non-thermal ablation of pulse field ablation. So still have that in same inherent mindset of how we're going to treat these patients. But now we have a better option in terms of safety, which is the main thing we're worried about when we're taking care of patients, much more so than speed of the procedure, things of that nature. Remember, these procedures, although percutaneous, we're still putting these in while your heart's still beating. You're not on bypass. The heart's beating. Things are moving around. We're doing this without seeing exactly what we're doing. We're using surrogates such as impedance, fluoroscopy, intracardiac echocardiogram. You really, really got to be sharp and on your best game every time you step into that electrophysiology lab.
Wow. And so this has really, you know, changed the space for AFib management. I mean, I heard from efficiency, you know, timing of procedures, being able to help more patients. The safety is a huge thing, recovery as well. Outcomes to be determined, but at this moment, still looking promising. And, you know, that tissue selectivity, you know, really minimizing just damaging the cardiomyocytes and not so much the nerves and the vessels. But, you know, one thing that does come up is sometimes that, you know, spasm. And I wonder how, you know, you guys approach that or anything else that comes up as you're doing the procedure compared to more of the RF approaches.
Yeah. So spasm occurs when you're ablating close to the coronary artery. And just as practice, I don't think Dr. DeSimone, I can say for me for sure, even I know Dr. DeSimone, we are not doing any ablation beyond the pulmonary vein isolation for which it is FDA approved. So if you are ablating close to the tricuspid annulus or mitral annulus where the coronary arteries are going to be, that's where there is a risk of creating a spasm. But if you are doing a wide area circumferential ablation, or ablating inside the pulmonary vein, which you can now with pulse field ablation, I don't see any reason for spasm occurring in that particular location. And some of the spasms, what have been reported, have been really a little bit of off-label use of trying to do linear ablation to treat flutters on the cavotricuspid isthmus or mitral isthmus. That's where spasms have been seen. But, you know, if a patient gets a spasm or you do ablate in that location, there are very well thought through protocols on using nitroglycerin before and after to make sure that, you know, the patient gets through the spasm and don't get any myocardial injury due to that.
Wonderful. And Dr. DeSimone, if you just want to add to that, and sometimes, you know, the thought that a bigger thing in the past was pulmonary vein stenosis. And if you could just, you know, mention something along those lines.
Definitely. And to get back to Abhishek's point, I think this is really, really important. We haven't thrown radio frequency out. So we haven't thrown the baby out with the bathwater. Radio frequency is still a critical part of our collection in our toolbox. The pulse field is just another tool, but it's an important tool, and it's going to become more and more widely available, and it's going to spread out, as I think we're going to talk about later, into other arrhythmias. But as you mentioned, I like how you really are pushing at us that tell me about the pulmonary vein stenosis, all these things. You know, with radio frequency, that's kind of early on where they found the side effects down the road, and that could be very troublesome for patients and very debilitating. Here, it's probably given us the option to be more effective at treating atrial fibrillation. Why do I say this? When we're doing atrial fibrillation ablation, we're trying to isolate the pulmonary vein muscle sleeve from electrically being in contact with the rest of the left atrium. When we do that, when we do this pulmonary vein isolation approach, especially with radio frequency as we did, we're trying to maintain ourselves outside of the pulmonary veins because the thermal injury would cause tissue neoplasia and swelling and stenosis. With pulse field ablation, we're probably, if not definitely, ablating inside the pulmonary veins. Now, the reason that's important is because think about it. If you were in a zoo and you knew that there was a lion coming to get you, Anthony, and you wanted to make yourself very protected, if you want to make sure that that lion never gets out of the cage and mauls you, rather than putting up a great fence or a cement barrier, you'd rather just shoot the lion, right? And again, I'm just using this as an illustrative point. We love lions and animals altogether, but I'm just saying this allows us to go directly after the inciting factor. So it's kind of moving from pulmonary vein isolation to a pulmonary vein ablation approach. So you're ablating that muscle tissue itself. And I think that is probably what's going to lead to this being slightly better, or at least presumably better than our thermal approaches where we're just putting up a barrier. Here, we're going right after the muscle sleeve itself.
Wow. That makes a lot of sense. And I mean, it seems like as long as you have good, you know, tissue contact, you even probably minimize hemolysis as well. And so there's a lot of good things. I guess, you know, Dr. Deshmukh, what are you thinking about? This tech field is advancing very quickly. And just in the last, you know, probably decade, but 30 years, we've seen almost a huge change in the field. Where do you kind of see this technology heading? Other arrhythmias or clinical scenarios that we might be using PFA in the future?
Thanks, Anthony. No, I think it's very, very promising. And this is probably the most, actually, I envy you at your life stage right now, because this is probably the most exciting time to be in electrophysiology and do ablations. Because, you know, back in the day, I remember at least when I was in training 10 years back, each AF ablation would take 6 to 8 hours. And then that would dissuade people away from EP. And that's how EP got the kind of a bad rep that the procedures are very long and all that. But now, you know, especially when Dr. DeSimone does it, I think that AF ablation is as quick as you can ever see any other procedure done in the heart. So it's really come a long way, thanks to all the contributions from several groups around the world. But I think, you know, there are still some unanswered questions which we will learn over a period of time. One would be how to really assess if the tissue is actually ablated or killed. whichever way we are trying to kill it. And, you know, with RF ablation also, there was no good way, but there were several surrogates by which we could know whether the tissue has been ablated. And hopefully with the PFA, we'll start to learn more about it, you know, if how to assess actual ablation and success of an ablation of a tissue. And I think, you know, if it works well in the atrium, I don't see any reason why it will not work in the ventricle, you know, and, you know, with ventricular arrhythmias, especially sicker hearts, you know, if it can be an effective procedure where you can actually make good transmural lesions to ablate the substrate, I think it will go a long way in reducing the arrhythmia burden, regardless of which arrhythmia you ablate. You know, our group has had some off-label experience of using some of the newer catheters in the ventricle with promising results. But, you know, but Dr. DeSimone potentially can talk to you more about it, about where the field is going from the ventricle standpoint.
I would underscore what Abhishek says. These things are very promising. And I think not only is it the best time to be under Dr. Deshmukh's tutelage and be in his EP training program, but it's an even better time to be a patient. I'll tell you why. I think that you get the safer and you get the more abilities to have expanded toolbox so that we could use both radiofrequency and pulse field ablation. Now, where the field's going in terms of atrial fibrillation, it's clearly going to be who's going to have the best catheter. And this is, again, a great thing for us, a great thing for patients, because the device companies who put in all of these funds and run these trials, because they want to have the best catheter. They want to be the best catheter on the market that everybody uses, the ones that the patients are recommending and requesting. So that's a great thing, because they're all fighting and jockeying for who's got the best catheter, and that leads to better catheters for our patients and better and easier catheters for us to use. So great time to be a patient. Where the field's heading is clearly, it's not even if, it's when. It's heading into the ventricle for PVC ablations, premature ventricular contractions, as well as ventricular tachycardia, VT ablations. It's going to happen there, not only for a safety, but even probably for an efficacy. You know, if these lesions are delivered in a relatively short time, it's different in how the biophysics occur with radio frequency. So the way you deliver a thermal lesion and, you know, right next door, you kind of have this penumbra of a thermal tissue that's there that's kind of already got swelling and edema, and you don't get a good secondary lesion. You don't see that with the pulse field ablation. These are very brief deliveries, and they probably are going to perform better when you have scar in the heart, as opposed to what radio frequency would be capable of doing. So exciting time to be a patient, exciting time to be an electrophysiologist. It's always an exciting time to be an electrophysiologist, but you're going to be seeing Dr. Deshmukh, and he's going to be doing fantastic ablation procedures for you. And they're going to be complex, but you have the ability in these catheters to do pulse field ablation, and you'll be able to toggle in between pulse field as well as radio frequency in the same catheter. One of these is already out on the market. So it makes it an exciting time right now in this field. We all have to remain humble and be step-by-step approach to these and make sure these are safe, but we're learning as we go along.
Well, you heard it here. You know, I mean, the pulse field ablation is really transforming AFib management, and even now probably expanding, as we're seeing, into other areas, including the ventricle. But it's still not going to, you know, get away from radio frequency, where it has its, you know, areas that it can help as well. And so, I mean, PFA is really changing in terms of safety advantages, and really shifting the strategies of how we're using this technology. Again, Dr. DeSimone, Dr. Deshmukh, thank you for joining us. This is an exciting time, as you mentioned. I look forward to working with you both and learning from you in the lab, and I hope you'll join us again here in the future.
Absolutely. Thank Great. You so much.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you for joining us today. We invite you to share your thoughts and suggestions about the podcast at cveducation.mayo.edu. Be sure to subscribe to a Mayo Clinic Cardiovascular CME podcast on your favorite platform, and tune in every other week to explore today's most pressing electrocardiography topics with your colleagues at Mayo Clinic.
This has been a Mayo Clinic podcast.